essentially you had lots of middling sorts of people who wanted a more localist government. They didn't want the decisions made by a far removed, distant federal government. One has to understand that suddenly you're going to have a House of Representatives that has only 65 members. This is for a population of 4 million. This was a very tiny House of Representatives. When you consider that the state legislators added up together constituted maybe 1,200 people, suddenly you're going to have all of your major decisions for your country made by 65 people instead of 1,200 people. It's a very elitist movement, and it cuts out the decision-making of middling people who don't think they're going to get to the capital. Take the state of North Carolina, has given 5 representatives. In its state legislature may have 250 representatives. The idea is that the decision-making will be made by the 5 congressmen who go to the House of Representatives instead of the 250 in the state legislature. You change the level of decision making and you get a different sort of person making the decision. And that is precisely what the Federalists, that is the people who supported the Constitution, wanted to do. They thought that if only 5 people were making this decision in North Carolina, there are probably only 5 college graduates in North Carolina. The chances are those 5 college graduates would be the ones going to the Congress and making the decisions in lieu of the 250 in the state legislature. So there's a kind of elitist, aristocratic bias that this was an aristocratic document designed to protect the interests of aristocrats in the society. And that, of course, was the major charge made by the anti-federalists, the opponents of the Constitution. Very few of them have college education, so you have a series of quite extraordinary men coming out of nowhere. Melanchthon Smith in New York. He's up against Alexander Hamilton, Robert Livingston. These are college graduates and bright people. But Smith, uneducated, that is, no college degree, he gives them a run for their money in the debates. He really argues quite strongly for localist representation. People want people of their own kind representing them, and if their own kind is by class or ethnicity or race, we understand that perfectly, and that's exactly what these middling sorts of people were arguing. We don't want people like Alexander Hamilton making decisions for us middling people. In the end, of course, Melanchthon Smith votes for the Constitution because he realizes that by 1787-88, it's clear that if you don't have this Constitution, it's going to be nothing. And so he wants something. He just doesn't want this particular government, but better this than nothing. He doesn't want anarchy. He doesn't want the states to fall apart. And that's the best thing the Federalists have going for them, because they create a document, it's out there, and there's really no alternative.